Okay, let's do this, right? Should we just do it? Welcome. Hey now, PSW staff, clients, and friends joining us for a lovely Tuesday morning class. Welcome. Today, you're going to get me in your results for James Cameron's Titanic film. Huge film. So think of a good romantic, soothing score for that. And we'll see the results for Friday. That was a lot of fun. Today, we're going to go back in time, a long time, and look at maybe the most famous English composer. So we've talked about Bach. We talked about Monteverdi. Talked about Vivaldi, Italians and Germans mostly. But I mean, what was going on in England? Wasn't anyone writing music in England? Well, you bet your ass they were. We had this guy writing some wonderful, great, great music. Was kind of the first to bring the English opera to the scene. Today we're gonna be looking at a real genius composer, Henry Purcell. Although Purcell incorporated Italian and French music in his music, musical writings, Purcell was uniquely English. He was born in London, but part of the Baroque period that we've been looking at. One of the greatest English composers of all time. When are we talking about? I mean, what is this, the 1960s? No. Way before then. We have to bring up my free timeline that I re-registered, and let's take a look at where he is. He's before Bach. He's before Vivaldi. He's after Monteverdi. Monteverdi was the very famous Italian composer that kind of wrote the first opera. I mean, pretty much. There's other people, but maybe the first good opera. So he's going on a long time in the Baroque era of music. Monteverdi was kind of late Renaissance, early Baroque. And then by the time we get to Henry Purcell, we're in the Baroque, baby, right there. So his music covered a broad array of genres and music for the stage, for the church, as well as for the English court. We're going to take a look at his life, but first we got to get over there. So let's leave Rosarito Beach in Mexico, where they filmed the Titanic, and let's go over to England, which I think is in Europe, right? Purcell's born in 1659, dies in 1695 at the age of 36, which is my age. But, you know, back then, 36 was probably like 96, maybe. I don't know. But born into an extremely pretty privileged upbringing with his two brothers and his mother and father. They were very well connected to the English court and were pretty wealthy. And Henry's interest in music began when he was a very young child, and said that his first piece was written by the time he was about 9 years old. And his earliest work was an ode for King Charles's birthday in 1670. Purcell's music was—he was a choirster. He was a choir boy as a young age until his voice, broke, and then he became an assistant to the organ builder who held the post there. And he landed a pretty impressive job as an organist for the Westminster Abbey, which is a huge, huge honor. Just by the age of 20, he's already doing that. Uh, Now, if you remember, the piano wasn't really around until 1700 or so. So mostly people are writing on the organ and harpsichords and keyboards like that. And while he's the organist, he's pretty much pursuing his music in the style of sacred music. Now, we've talked about, which is the church, right? Non-secular music. That's kind of what he's writing. But between 1680, 1688, he's starting writing for the theater too, including seven plays. And this is when Purcell's kind of credited with introducing opera to British high society, to the British monarch, to the king. This is a huge thing that happens because people aren't really sure what to do with this new thing called opera. You know, like we talked about Middle Ages, people were kind of just, I mean, dicking around with lutes and, you know, just playing nice little songs in the countrysides and all that, and that's great. But then with opera, you get dramatic purpose. You get Monteverdi, who would take poetry, would take, you know, stories and put music to them to make them, you know, into several musical acts. And like I've talked about many times, because of opera, because of theater, music in the theater, you know, we kind of get what we see now. We get films, which are mostly operas, only, you know, without singing throughout the whole time, but they're stories, you know, with dramatic purpose. So he's bringing this to England. He's really, one of his biggest pieces is Dido and Aeneas. Was performed for the first time, and that was huge. Opera was unknown at the time that Purcell's groundbreaking opera was performed, and it was first performed by a girls' boarding school that was mostly made up of a selection of just amateur singers, kind of like Vivaldi. Remember, he was the leader of an orphanage and would get them to perform a lot of his music, and thank God he did. So despite humble beginnings, Purcell was really able to do, to take this kind of untrained girls choir and create a small opera that became into a big opera. And actually it's one of the most famous operas of all time, Dido and Aeneas. And we're going to, you know, all the music we've been listening to now and later, a lot of those pieces are from this opera work. Dido, considered the first genuine English opera. So he's doing that. People are taking note of him. He dies at 36. There's a few different theories on his death, and one that he was returning one night and he caught a really bad chill and found out that his wife locked him out of the house. Probably the most reasonable explanation is that it was tuberculosis, so that's too bad. What are we listening to? What's the style of this? We've talked about the Baroque style. Something that Purcell is doing is in his secular music is he's using a bass, a bass line. And we've talked about Bach, and you know, he was the master at using bass lines, right? And Purcell's also doing these very short melodic phrases that he's repeating over again as a bass line, with the right hand creating the chords. So if you have a bass line, chords, that's what songs are today. I mean, that's how a singer, songwriter, whether it's, I don't know, Billie Eilish and a guitar or Burt Bacharach and a piano, you get chords. And so these Baroque composers are, for the most part, playing just chords, bass line in the left, harmony chords in the right. I think that's part of why some of this music sounds very fresh and new still, because it's not just chaotic music. It's their songs in a sense. So the bass line, and he's also incorporating polyphony, and we looked at polyphony. Sounds like a tough word, but really it's not. Polyphony is really just consisting of two or more simultaneous lines going on. So if we all just sang one song, like if we all sang Happy Birthday, that's not polyphony, that's monophony. That's just one, everyone singing one line. If we have polyphony, if you start singing Happy Birthday, if I start singing a counter melody or any other thing counter that's not going in the same line, that's polyphony. They're independent musical lines. And we've talked about counterpoint. We won't get into counterpoint, but counterpoint is also, you know, polyphonic music. That's what he's doing. He's very, still pretty famous, you know, in pop culture. I mean, if you remember, Wendy Carlos. We talked about Wendy Carlos, the great composer in the 60s and the 70s, did the Switched on Bach, and that was a soundtrack for Kubrick's iconic film, Clockwork Orange. If you remember, this is a theme by Henry Purcell. A lot of composers were taken or influenced by Purcell. Benjamin Britten, who we'll do a class on, a 20th century British composer, amazing composer. And then another British composer we looked at, Michael Nyman. Michael Nyman is, Purcell's Michael Nyman's favorite composer of all time. And you can tell he's using one of Michael Nyman's first and best and biggest soundtracks is from Peter Greenaway's film, The Draftsman's Contract. We did a whole class on Michael Nyman and how he kind of upped the Baroque feel, meaning he would take this kind of bassline chords and amplify it, give it a driving force, but then put his own melodies over it. So what do I mean by that? Well, if we listen to his most famous piece, Chasing Sheeps is Best Left to Shepherds, let's first hear Purcell's and this is from Purcell's King Arthur. Take a listen to Purcell's thing, and then we're going to listen to Nyman's right after that. Okay, that's Henry Purcell. Let's listen to Michael Nyman's song from The Draftsman's Contract. Very, very similar, right? This particular soundtrack, I mean, Henry Purcell gets screen credit on this film with Michael Nyman, so he's not plagiarizing it. He's embellishing it. He's playing with Purcell's ideas. He's using his chord progressions. He's taken a lot from Purcell, but he's also realizing, hey, I can take some of this stuff, but then I'm going to give it my own voice and lay some other stuff. Another example is one of his other most famous pieces, Michael Nyman's pieces, Memorial, which is in Greenaway's Cook, the Thief, His Wife, and Her Lover. Let's first listen to Henry Purcell's piece, and then we're going to juxtapose it later. Very theatrical, very tense, right? Let's listen to Nyman's Memorial. I mean, exact same chord progressions, right? Would you say it's plagiarized? No, because what Michael Nyman does is he's taking this, he's adding his own melody to it afterwards, because in Purcell's music, they start singing. But he's taking that same chord progression that still is so, I mean, some of these chord progressions that Bach used, Vivaldi especially, they're great chord progressions that still work today in music. So why not keep using them and then add your own melody in? I mean, that's a great formula. It's like taking Beatles, chord progressions and then making your own song on top of the Beatles, where you're not using their own melody, but you're using a great foundation. The Baroque composers laid a great foundation of good songwriting music that could be made even better. And that's why I think the Baroque period is so interesting, so great to like for us to listen to this kind of music that's written like 500 years ago that is still really relevant to what we're listening to now. Even Pete Townsend of The Who, we did a whole class on Tommy, said that Purcell's harmonies were really influenced in Pinball Wizard and other very famous songs that The Who did. So Wendy Carlos, Pete Townsend, Michael Nyman, all 20th century songwriter composers are saying, boy, this guy Purcell wrote great music hundreds and hundreds of years ago. Let's riff on this music. Let's be influenced by this music. So just a small taste of another great Baroque genius composer, Henry Purcell. So hope you liked that. I love his music. I love the theatricality of it. It's very, it's just exciting music. The same with Bach. I mean, Gregorian chants, all that other kind of stuff is very lovely music, very pristine music. When you get to Baroque music, you get kind of early songwriting where it's like, yeah, you can tap your foot, you can feel it. And this is, of course, before Mozart in the classical period. So they're starting something just so much fun, so original. So I'm giddy with this stuff. I love Henry Purcell, another great Baroque composer. Okay, that's it. Tomorrow I got something really, really fun planned. Have no idea what it is, but no, I do. Miss you, love you, hope you enjoyed this, and see you tomorrow.